We spoke of the various metaphors in Buddhism stemming out of different cultural context, and how it is the cultural context that determines and shapes how Buddhism is expressed. So we live in a different paradigm, a different context. So it's important not to get caught up with the metaphors and understand the meaning behind it as best we can. I also spoke about obstructions, perceived obstructions that we may experience, and how to navigate through them. There are four different types. So the previous talks, recording is already available online, so you can check on that. So all this is in the context of post-awakening for different practitioners. So we continue in this section. And what follows is a kind of admonition, warning of what could go wrong in having these the Buddhist, the Chan Zen tradition would call it awakenings, but basically this is the experience of the dropping away of self-referentiality, this habit tendency of foregrounding me, I, mine, the center of everything. And that tendency has neurological basis as well, because the way that we're neurologically wired is to project and instill a sense of subjectivity. I'm sitting over here, all of you are over there, so there's a spatial sense of self in this room. But beyond the kind of spatial sense of self, there's also the narrative sense of self. There's a kind of subjecthood. And these are what I call, it's actually the way that we're wired. So it helps, the way that we're wired helps us to survive, right? Throughout millennia. So there's no real problems there. The problem is we develop this habit tendency of relying on this byproduct of our thinking, perception, feeling that has this neurological, anatomical basis, this byproduct of subjecthood. So we can have subjectivity, but there's no need for a fixed subjecthood. So the illusion of this fixed, reified sense of self separate from everything. We attach to that and believe it to be us. So that is the object of critique in Buddhism, to put it in a kind of modern language. So it's not that the experience of no self, you suddenly lose who you are, or you're blissed out in this kind of zone of nebulous kind of oneness. That would be the Buddhist critique of altered states of consciousness. which is another side product, you know, kind of illusory experiences. So but because we are so steeped into our reference points, physiological, biographical, is there a way to put narrative into call? Narratological, you know? We're so steeped in that. So when this grasping suddenly vanishes, this loss of reference point, without a strong foundation in virtue, meditation practice can have negative consequences. So that's why in Buddha Dharma we talk about precept, meditation, and then wisdom. There's a reason why there must be an ethical foundation based on virtue. Otherwise, without the boundaries and the identities, when that kind of stripped away, anything can go. So that's what follows in the next few lines, and I'll read them, and we'll go into some depth. Any questions so far? That's a kind of quick crash course on Buddhist notion of awakening. This is not altered states of consciousness. It's not we lose who we are. Neurologically, everything works fine. We still have subjectivity. We still know we're here and you're over there. But this habit of reifying, identifying, like this is just the way it is. I am just me. And you are actually over there. This kind of attachment is absent. Now, I should say that absent, but we live, we're embodied beings in a context, in a culture. Especially when the person's establishing the foundation of cultivating virtue, practice of meditation. So when these experiences come, even though it could be earth-shattering, all the walls, boundaries, identities kind of suddenly vanish away, we don't fall apart, right? So, and because of that sense of freedom, in fact, the relationship that we have with ourselves, with our body, with our thoughts and feelings, actually changes. Before, I mean, we think of something sad, we just become sad, depressed. You think of something happy, completely elated. Right? So we're like a puppet on strings. You happen to think of this, you just become that. So that relationship change, what I mean by this is, we're less tethered to our own thoughts and feelings anymore. Right? So there's a sense of liberation and freedom from that. We're still in an embodied way, living our lives. And our thoughts, because it's less tethered to our modeled way of thinking, habitual way of thinking, actually creativity starts to happen. Our mind becomes freer to make different connections. Right? Things that kind of locks us in emotionally, conceptually, there's a kind of porous relationship to that. We're not so attached to it. Do we have feelings? Yes. Great feelings. Emotions, yes. But they no longer define us. They no longer fixate on us. Kind of reify us to just limited to that. You know, when people have emotions, they typically make a big deal out of it. Like if you're sad, everything, the whole world looks so gloomy. Right? And if you're vexed, very troubled, you know, every little thing becomes a thing because we're steeped there, we're locked to it. So our attachment reifies, solidifies that, so we can't break free from it. So the emotions freely flow, thoughts making connections, but we're no longer so tethered to it. Right? So friends, family, a student passes away, and there's sadness. Right? There's missing of the person. But there's so much more, too. Right? So when a person, ordinary people are sad, they're just sad through and through. Right? They can't think of alternative ways of looking at this. Why? Because they're tethered to it. They're defined by it. So even when there's sadness, sadness doesn't define us. There's other aspects that are quite wonderful. Just like the furniture in the room, you know, and the people in this room, the space, right? The spaciousness of this room is not defined by all the cushions or the people. The spaciousness, it's already here. It's always been here. But the room could be cluttered and messy or quite empty. And there's a strong emotion. One furniture, for example, strong emotion, it doesn't preclude other emotions, other memories, right? Other feelings, other people. Does that make sense? So, but if you think about when we were anxious, you know, at the time when we were anxious, when we were sad, when we were depressed, when we strong emotions, usually we're just that. We can't think outside of that. We're just locked into it. So that is the attachment. Right? That is what hinders the freedom that we already are. The freedom that we already are. So there's a so it's not like a common misconceptions of what enlightenment is, or some kind of altered state, or some kind of vacuity, or kind of stoic. You know, I've had students who think that there's a particular model to awakened beings. You know, they're kind of dispassionate, quiet, solemn. You know, people have personality. You don't lose your personality. And so that's a quick context for, because several of you are new here, right? And haven't heard the previous talks. So, but what follows is that dropping away of borders, boundaries, identities. If the foundation is not good, have some problems, right? So here are some of the problems. And these problems, you shouldn't think about, well, I'm not awakened yet, so they don't really apply to me. Well, they apply to you still. because the different expectations and cultural imprints on us and the shifting of our moods and attitudes can also get us caught up in these. Okay, so these lines are quite simple, but with the introduction and prelude, makes it more important. It sounds like it's good, right? Can't wait what he's going to say. Still hasn't said anything yet. Just setting up the context, right? So, so the text goes, being apathetic to emptiness is to deny cause and effect. This brings calamities beyond measure. Rejecting existence and grasping emptiness is the same mistake, like jumping into fire to avoid drowning. Does anyone do that? Don't try it. The next four lines. If you discard the illusory mind and grasp the true principle or the truth, this mind of grasping and discarding will be mired in clever deceptions. Not understanding this, practitioners engage in cultivation and perilously mistake a thief for their own son. How is that related to post-awakening practitioners? They should, they're awake, they have experienced some kind of awakening. They should know this, right? Not necessary. Again, the foundation is very important. Context, because the truth is this dropping away of self-referential attachment tendencies can happen to and has happened to anyone prior to some kind of spiritual path practice. In fact, many people go into spiritual practice because when they were young, in the teenage years, in the 20s, they've experienced something like this. And now they have set themselves on a course of practice. And they come to Buddhist text and read it. Oh, this is exactly what I experienced. And they seek after it again. Very common. So some of these problems deals with the lack of foundation, and the shallowness of their awakening experiences. So people that kind of just stumble upon this sudden dropping away, this is what I would call like a blind cat catching a dead mouse. Did the cat catch mouse? Yeah, it did. Is it alive? No, it's just dead. Was it intentional? No, just kind of stumbled upon it. So, is that a kind of dropping away? Is it genuine? Yeah, it's. But is it profound or deep? Not really. Right. So coming out of that, because our habit tendency of mistaking our subjectivity, the natural functioning of our eye, ear, nose, tongue, body, mind, its perceptual process, with subjecthood, it's so deeply ingrained, that such shallow experiences, a flash of such experiences, the self-referentiality quickly comes back. And make that experience into a thing and then attach to it. Okay. Kind of amplifying that experience, the boundaryless, wallless, identityless, that kind of open freedom. Make it into a thing and then chase after. But sometimes, even with the context of having some foundation in practice, because of all the stories, the cultural expressions, trappings of how ancient awakened teachers have behaved, and we read about them. And then when one experiences this, they mistaken the aberrations for the norm. What do I say this? Because in the history of Chan Zen and Buddhism in general, there being a few practitioners, great practitioners, who are really, the records of them, they are not the norm. They are aberrations. They are the exceptions, you know? Like Master Ling Ji, after he awakens, goes up to the teacher, punch him 3 times in the stomach, knocks down the teacher. The teacher is kind of happy. He's awakened, but it's okay, it's fine. You know, it's just Ling Ji. It's just his personality, you know. And there are contemporary teachers that behave kind of very odd, you know, way. They are not the norm, right? They are the exceptions. And it has to do with their personality, the circumstances that led to the awakening, and the depth of it, the depth of the awakening. But in the discourse record, historical records, everything is not the norm. This is true back then, just as now. Everything that's like strange, the exception, becomes amplified by media, right? Same thing. Back then, they don't have TV, they don't have internet. What do they have? Records, printed, you know, that was the media, right? So it becomes like these stories. But these stories of exception, they don't put it in a context. I mean, even Master Ling Ji, he's not going around punching people. He's not doing that. He was a perfect monk, uphold precept. You know, I don't really know why he punched his teacher, right? Maybe it's just some pent up energy that observing precepts, all this tension, which he was doing that. You know, when that liberation was so powerful, he was so happy, he saw his teacher, and said, "Your Buddha Dharma is nothing at all." Wham! You know? So He hasn't done that since. Did it once. So these kind of cultural trappings and expressions becomes the norm of how certain people express themselves. That means their awakening is pretty shallow. Why? Because they transcended themselves. They haven't transcended the culture. So they've seen through itself this freedom, it's not deep enough to actually see through and through of how cultural norms shape our decisions, shape our choices, the way that we express things. You know? So the way what is accepted as norm, what is accepted as not normal, what is appropriate, what is inappropriate. Something inappropriate, you know, in the old records, small percentage is expressed as something appropriate. You know, punch your teacher or, you know, something. Give a loud scream and then cry at the same time. There are cases like that. Or give a loud laugh or something. Right? So when everyone's quiet, right? So these kind of things kind of become part of our understanding of how things are supposed to be, right? How awakening is supposed to be. So you don't see Shakyamuni Buddha or any of the great practitioners doing any of that sort, right? The Buddha was someone that saw through not only himself, but saw through the cultural trappings, changed the whole paradigm of a civilization built on the caste system. The slaves in the Vedic tradition, they just turn to dust. They can't engage in any spiritual practice. He says, no, slaves, you can practice. Women, you know, just staying home and cook for your husband. Bear children. He says, no, you come. So that's a big paradigm shift. So not only critique of the self, but critique of the construct, the very construct of civilization and culture. Right? So because of the shallowness of awakening, or some personal proclivities that certain practitioners have when they experience this, they, you know, act funny, right? Not only that, because of the shallowness, and since all things are empty, they haven't really come back to life yet. Right? So in Chan, we distinguish those people who have died the great death, but one must also come back fully to life. Right? So dying the great death means the attachment, reification, habit tendencies, cultural trappings kind of suddenly vanishes. Bringing back to life or coming back to life means the full functioning of this wisdom in action. Now, this wisdom of selflessness in action, what is that? That's compassion. There's no self-referential agenda anymore. So compassion is able to bring this person back to life. How? Interacting with people, circumstances, the complexity of life and daily life. So the response of selfless wisdom to circumstances in life, the person comes back to life. What would prevent a person from doing that? Suppose an awakened person. They have attached to emptiness. They have attached to all things. They died the great death, and they think that's it. Right? So morality, ethics, these are humanly constructed. I don't need to follow that. Right? So they've attached. So their experience becomes source of the attachment. And now I'm free from that. Right? So so awakening is becoming a thing. That's why they're apathetic. Being apathetic, it shouldn't be to emptiness. It should be being apathetic in emptiness. Maybe Sarah can change the text. Being apathetic in emptiness is to deny cause and effect. So there, the Chan critique to this is these people have died the great death and they're abiding in this dead emptiness. So there's no cause and effect. Cause and effect here stands for morality. So this kind of apathy, amoral value stemming from emptiness become a source of attachment. And that's why it brings calamities beyond measure. Because their experience is shallow and they have mistaken this freedom as a source of attachment. Why? Because the self is so steeped and so deep-rooted, it quickly comes back. And because of that, they think they can do what they please. And why does it bring calamities? We have witnessed this. In all spiritual traditions, great practitioners, they fall from, what is that called? The expression, fall from grace, something. And students prop them up on a pedestal, and then they lose sight. They lack what? Humility. And they lack the foundation of virtue. So what happens? They think they can, so they become abusive to students. They take advantage of students. They break precepts. And we have plenty of stories of that. How many of you know the stories? Okay, majority don't know. Ignorance is bliss. There's a lot of this going on. Maybe not like, I shouldn't say a lot. But those cases are amplified by media. It seems like it's like all over the place. But the majority of people are not, you know, the practitioners are not experiencing this. But it has happened. Your basic amoral practices of sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Right? So, maybe not the rock and roll part. So, bring calamities to who? To all those around. And that's really sad. Because they're real people, real lives, and they come to trust in the teacher. You know? And the teacher does something like, you know, immoral. Because of their amoral values stemming from their experience. So that that becomes a big problem. That can become a big problem. And there are stories that I know fellow practitioners who lives are just destroyed, complete, traumatized by something like this. Someone that you look up to, but forget about spirituality, teachers and so on, just like people that you look up to in daily life, and that you respect, that you think has your best interest in their heart, yet they harm students. So that is great calamities, great disasters, trauma, and that's why one should never stop practicing. This ever-deepening of one's understanding, appreciation, experience. So always continue. If you meet someone, even this goes out to the teachers, if you meet someone who you feel you can study with, even though you are already a teacher, you study, you value. Maybe not give up your position as a teacher, but start to build a relationship and share different teachings. There's other ways to learn, right, to appreciate, to deepen our practice. My teacher was like that. I remember when we were at Queens, Chan Center. This must have been in the 90s. Through word of mouth, I don't know how we found out. I can't remember how we found out. Anyway, we discovered Master Xu Yun. That's our great grandmaster. Empty cloud. Chan master, one of the most important Chan masters in the 20th century. We discovered that there was a monk in Chinatown that used to be the attendant of Master Xu Yun, still around. We were ecstatic. My teacher quickly said, "Guo Gu, go to his monastery. Invite him. Find out where he is, which monastery, some information, and then let me know." So I go there, kind of scope out the situation, and come back. He's actually there. His name is such and such. And my teacher says, "Let's go." The way my teacher behaved, my teacher was already a great teacher, very respected, very humble. Personally invited him. I was supposed to pick him up, bring him to our center, but my teacher went with me. We both went and brought him to the center. Have a table, we have a meal set up, and just inquire about his experience with Master Xu Yun. He was, of course, a very young boy at the time. So just kind of sharing. And my teacher was very humble. Very humble. He doesn't have an air around him. I'm already an established teacher. So teachers are like that, let alone students. Right? So humility. Continue to practice. Don't be satisfied with little. Next line. Rejecting existence and grasping emptiness is the same mistake. That's what happens. Reifying, solidifying the puny little experience as some kind of ultimate state. In Chinese, we have a saying, there's always a mountain peak higher than whatever mountain that you're seeing. You know? There's always a body of water vast and open, spacious than whatever lake that you're swimming in. So what happens when we reject existence and grasp emptiness? Emptiness is supposed to be a teaching, an expedient means to teach attachment, teach craving, teach reifying, solidifying me, I, mine, the center of everything. Right? It's a medicine. If you grasp that, then it's like jumping into a fire to avoid drowning. Drowning in what? Samsara. Now, fire in early Buddhist texts, it's a metaphor sometimes, iconographically and textually, for wisdom, the flame. Also in Chan, you know, passing through the flame, transmission of the lamp, you know, flame, fire. It's a metaphor for wisdom. So, and drowning is often associated with samsara. But when attachment is there, anything can be turned to source of suffering, problem. So jumping into the fire to avoid drowning in samsara, you jump into the fire, you get all burned up. This burning is not the wisdom burning. This burning, the wisdom has already turned to ignorance. Right? The flames of ignorance burning. It's just the other side of samsara. That's the first four line. And it further elaborates on this. Discarding the illusory mind, grasping true principle. That mind of grasping and discarding, grasping, rejecting, itself is already mired in clever deception. That's the mind's disease. So that very tendency of solidifying and reifying one's shallow experience of awakening into a thing, that's grasping. That's the very poison that kind of traps us into you know, this habit tendency of suffering. So not understanding this, you know, practitioners cultivate and engage in practices, and they've mistaken a thief for their son. So, relying on the wrong thing, depending on the wrong thing. It's like the analogy I have for something like this is, it's like asking a thief to clean your apartment. Mistake. You don't do that. You know, you don't do that. You go back, and everything's empty now. Not the nice type of emptiness, like literally things are gone, you know. So what is it stealing? What is the thief taking away? Our wisdom life. Our wisdom. So to ensure that we're forever trapped in this cell of darkness, of ignorance and delusion. Right. So he steals away the light. So we just continue in this darkness, not recognizing that this very attachment, reifying, that is the self. Right. So the self has already come back, already taken over again, Yeah, you may have had a glimpse of suddenly vanished, but then the self come back. What is that? That's awakening. you know, or do something, find my teacher. You know, so any one of you have some experiences, don't come punching me in the stomach. I'll grab one of these sticks and I'll whack you, put you in your place, right? So, yeah. So, tonight we spoke about, I began with a little context of what awakening is, mistaken understanding of it. And I went on to talk about this, highlighting the importance of foundation, the importance of seeing through the self-referentiality, and the importance of bringing that into daily life. Bringing that into daily life so our wisdom come to life. Not reifying the little meager experiences that we have, but to cultivate virtue. So not mistaking emptiness, selflessness as a thing. Something to gain. Something you've lost. That gaining, losing, having, lacking, wanting, you know, and letting go. These polarities are the expressions of self-referencing. That's the culprit. You know. So to continue to solidify the foundation and to engage in practice. The necessity of virtue, to build a solid meditative practice, and to have virtuous friends. So meeting the different circumstances in life will allow the wisdom to transform into action, which is compassion, selfless compassion. What needs to be done, what can be done in different circumstances, without getting yourself in the way. So that continued practice is very important, very important. So, let me see. And also, having a teacher to point these things out is very important. We live in a culture. This culture, there are certain shared values, norms, expectations. To continue what I was talking about last talk, about not mistaking the metaphors to be some kind of truth. Right? Different culture produce different metaphors explaining. So, to be able to see through not only our self-referencing, but the extent to which our cultures, the culture that we're in, impinges on us different meaning and values and expectations and norms, you know, to be able to see through that. And you're freer. There's another level of freedom. So the Chan position. I was just talking with a student today. You know, was very stressed from work, and he had a tendency to ruminate, to think. He's very intelligent, so he's able to think what's happening to him. And inadvertently get himself into a kind of a knot, you know. Why is that? Because we're so vested in our own thinking process. So it's so normalized. So when we think of something, we think, yeah, it's true. You know, but it's just thoughts. So we become incapable of distinguishing what is happening from our overlay of what's happening, the storyline that we've created. And the way we see things, the overlay, that's where the culture is. Cultural expectations, you know, your personal history, of course, individual ideas, but even your idea of thinking you as an individual, that's culture. Because the East Asian, they don't think of themselves as individual. They think of themselves in terms of the other. Do you know what I'm saying? So even that thinking of yourself as an individual experience, you're already conditioned a particular way. So be able to distinguish between the overlay that we have with what happened and what we think just happened. You have to learn to distinguish that as best as you can. You have to be able to expose, like I often say, exposing, embracing, accepting the culture, you know, the way that we're reared and so on. You have to expose it first, then you embrace it, and then you can learn to transform it, then you can be free from it. Does that make sense? So the different, the frame with which we engage in practice, if it's very simplistic, it's like, I want to be free from suffering, and I want to be free. I want to be happier, more peaceful. Then that's where you end up after practice. Right? Because we impose a particular frame to our practice. But if the framing is very sophisticated and profound and deep, you're questioning, what is freedom? What is humanity? What is this culture? And the freedom that comes from that, the liberation that comes from that, is very profound. Simple questions, simple answers. Big questions, big answers. No questions, no answer. Right? So the depth with which we can actually see through the veil of different layers of self, others, society, culture, then you engage in practice, that kind of exposing the different layers of it. That is another kind of practice, another layer of it, right? So, speaking of, in this context, you know, simple practice. I want to get away from samsara. I want to reach nirvana. Simple. Then you have simple answers. After you awaken, you still hold these two. A more sophisticated understanding. Well, samsara is actually not samsara. It's precisely because of samsara, all the troubles and sufferings and anguish that provided the means for me to realize freedom. Then the relationship you have with samsara, it's samsara, nirvana, samsara is the arena for awakening. See? So your relationship to all the sufferings is different. You see? So the different depth of selfing. Because in early Buddhism, self does not necessarily mean, even though in English, the S-E-L-V, F, you know, self, it has a different meaning in early Buddhism. In the Western context, self, just me, I, mine, in this context of individualism, self, that's not the self that early Buddhism is talking about. That's not the self that Buddha Dharma is talking about. Right? They're referring to like, this gong has no self. This cup has no self. So what are they talking about self? You see? So the kind of thing that we project onto Buddha Dharmas needs to be questioned. The cultural baggage that we bring needs to be questioned. They're talking about kind of interwoven separate existence that tend to be fixed. That is no self. Right? And that applies to culture. That's why Shakyamuni Buddha, when he awakened, he transcended not only this individualism self, the culture. That's why the paradigm shift. See, great teachers are like that. Shifts paradigms as opposed to just me, I'm free. So even after you're free, you still think of me, I'm the one who's free. That's attachment there. Does that make sense? Yeah. So what is freedom? What is awakening? What is the self? What is culture? How does self relate to culture? Who do we think we are? In our embeddedness to everything around. Right? So what is that? I guess the last message I have for tonight is there's ever-deepening states of awakening, of imminent transcendence. In the world, you're free. Not like, get out of the world. Like, nirvana. Right? Leave behind. A little philosophical I ended on, maybe. Is it difficult? Is it too abstract? A little bit? Yeah. Don't want to worry about it. Just listen here. Just things that doesn't stick, so throw it away. Whatever takeaway you have, just can think about it. That's your takeaway.